All of you for one day national level webinar on natural Shola forest, a paradise of biodiversity. Prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. Now I welcome all of you to Sanga prayer song Tamil Thai Valtu. Thank you. Welcome, address. It's pleasure to start this auspicious occasion by heartily welcoming everybody. I would like to welcome our enthusiastic head of the botany department, Dr. B. Mahesh Kumar, sir. Welcome, sir. Next, I would like to extend a special welcome to our chief guest, Dr. R. Ramasubu, sir, assistant professor, Department of Biology, Gandhigram Rural Institute, Dindigul. Hearty welcome you, sir. The road to success is always under construction. The constructing staff members without any failures, they give bright future to the students. I welcome all the staff members present here. Welcome, sir and ma'am. Students' life is the seed of our life. Plant trees wisely. I welcome all the students present here. Once again, I welcome you all. Thank you. Next, I would like to call upon Dr. V. Uma Ma'am, Assistant Professor of Botany Department, G. Vengadaswamy Naidu College, to introduce our enthusiastic chief guest. Please, ma'am.
Good afternoon to all. Respected Secretary Sir and beloved Principal Ma'am and Head of the Department, Dr. B. Maheshmar Sir, staff members and my dear students, very good afternoon to you all. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our chief guest, Dr. R. Ramasubu, Assistant Professor, Gandhigram Deemed University, Gandhigram. He did his UG, PG and MPhil from Madurai Kamarajar University and did the doctoral program from Tropical Botanical Garden and Research Institute, Trivandrum, Kerala. He has worked in various research and academic institutions like Tropical Botanical Garden and Research Institute and Premier College at Kerala, Sri AMM Murugappa Chettiar Research Center, Chennai and CSIR Madras Complex, Chennai. Now he is working as Assistant Professor of Botany at Gandhigram Rural University, Gandhigram. He visited abroad like Germany, Malaysia for collaborative research. He attended 14 national and international workshops and organized four refresher courses, six training programs. He handled five research projects like UGC, DST, DPT, SERB. Then he handled 7 PhD scholars and 73 MPhil students. He got many awards like Indian Association of Angiosperm Taxonomies and received Talented Scientist Award from Periyar University. He is member of various professional bodies and holding many honorary positions. member of Environmental Evaluation Committee, PhD thesis evaluator and external examiner in Bharathiyar University, Bharathidasan University, MS University, Calicut, Kannur and Karpakam Universities. Editor-in-Chief of International Journal of Agriculture Science Research. We are privileged to have such an eminent person like Ramasubu to deliver webinar Solar Forest, a Paradise of Biodiversity, today at our college. Thank you, sir. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your detailed introduction. Nature. Nature is not a place to visit. It's a home. And nothing is more beautiful than the loveliness of the woods before sunrise. It's a time for gathering you. Now I would like to call upon Dr. R. Ramasubu sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Biology, Gandhigram Rural Institute, Dindigul, to deliver the speech about Solar Forest, a paradise of biodiversity. Please, sir.
Thank you so much. Most respected Madam Principal, respected Head of the Department of Botany, Dr. Magesh Kumar, dear Organizing Secretary Dr. Sellu Raj, esteemed faculties of Department of Botany, Madam Dr. Uma, Dr. N. Karthik, Dr. K. Marisamy, Dr. P. Kumar, as well as the esteemed faculties connected by online, research scholars, and my dear friends, very good evening. It's my privilege to share my views as well as the knowledge on forest biodiversity through this topic. Also, it's my duty to thank the management, principal, head of the department, and the other faculty members of Department of Botany, GVN College, for providing such opportunity to share my views on Solar Forest ecosystem. So as we know, India is one among the mega biodiversity country, as reported, with a wide range of biodiversity, including plants, animals, and microbes. Also, India has blessed with a wonderful biodiversity with a good quality of forest in its landmass. However, the large area of such ecosystem need immediate attention. Particularly, but we have a very limited attention on such a forest ecosystem on conservation perspective. So this topic is exclusively on one such ecosystem under verge of extinction and also need immediate conservation action. So today, what we are going to discuss, in the sense this topic is exclusively related with the solar forest ecosystem. I think, is it visible, sir? Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir, it's visible. You can proceed, sir. Please.
This topic is mostly related to the forest ecosystem. Here we are going to cover the diversity and distribution of various components of solar forest ecosystem, then ecological perspective of this solar forest, as well as what are the threats. That means how we are damaging such a wonderful ecosystem by various components. This is what we are going to discuss today. Yes. Yes. So before entering to this topic, we must have a basic understanding related with the vegetation. So far, 12 different types of natural vegetation have been reported in the earth. But fortunately, India, as well as Indian subcontinent, occupied with the three important forest types, like a monsoon forest, tropical rainforest, as well as dry deciduous forest. So here, you might have been heard about the word hotspot. What do you mean by hotspot? That means the area with higher species richness. So far, 35 biodiversity hotspots have been reported in the world, particularly Asia Pacific ranked with the top. That means about 14 hotspots have been reported. In India, we have three different important hotspots: Western Ghats, Eastern Himalayas, as well as Western Himalayas. These are the three important areas that have been considered as a biodiversity hotspots in India. So, regarding forest wealth of India, according to Forest Survey of India 1997, So far, 6.3 lakh square kilometers have been reported as a forest. Interestingly, each country should have their land mass with 20% of the forest. Fortunately, India is satisfied with the forest occupancy with the tropical wet evergreen forest in the northeast to tropical thorn forest in the central and western India. Not only that, we have 16 major forest types have been reported along with the 221 subtypes. Apart from this regular classification of forests, we have also grassland, wetlands, mangroves, desert, as well as a coral reef. So this map clearly shows about the vegetation cover of Indian subcontinent as well as the entire part of the India. So here, wherever the green patches is, can be seen, in that the vegetation is occupied in a proper way. So regarding biogeography, I hope you might have heard about this word. Based upon the biogeographical value, the India can be classified into 10 different regions. Of that, the Western Ghats is the most important component. So when compared to the Trans-Himalayas, Himalayas, desert, semi-arid, Deccan Peninsula, Gangetic Plain, Northeast India, island as well as the coast, is the most significant since we have been, situated in the wonderful ecosystem. So this is what I told the Western Ghats. Western Ghats is a continuous chain of mountains of 1,600 kilometers running parallel to west coast from River Tapti to Kanyakumari. Not only that, it crosses about 6 different states without any gap. But of course, 2 naturally forming gap can be seen, one at Palkad gap as well as another one is Chengkota gap. So these are the few important significant regions in Western Ghats of India. So here, don't think that the Western Ghats ends only in India, but the considerable part of the Western Ghats has extended up to Sri Lanka. So the Western Ghats, in the sense, we are sharing with Sri Lanka too. So here, these are the few important high altitude biodiversity hotspots, starting from Anaimudi, the highest peak in South India, Mannanmalai, Thottapetta, Mukkurthi, Vandaru Peak, Banasarama Peak, then Thevarmala, Babu Budhanari Hills, Kudremukh, then Agastyamala, Madikeri, so on. So these are the few important areas in the high altitude with the high species richness. That is what we named as a biodiversity hotspot. So however it is, significant. Otherwise, what I have, presented the title as a biodiversity hotspot, not only that, paradise. However it is paradise. See, here, if you analyze the floristic wealth of the Western Ghats, particularly, so the Western Ghats alone shares about 27% of the Indian flora, which includes 6,500 species of flowering plants alone, which includes 2,253 endemic species. Endemic in the sense, the taxa may be a plant, animal, or microbes restricted to the particular region. That is what we named as endemic. So not only the plants, but also some birds, about 500 birds, 120 species of amphibians, 130 species of mammals, and 156 species of reptiles. If we analyze the biodiversity of the entire Western Ghats, the southern part of the Western Ghats is comparatively rich biodiversity when compared to the northern part. See here, these are the 4 different as well as important biodiversity region in which a higher number of plant species have been reported. See here, Agastyamalai 2000 species, Nilgiris 2600 species, Silent Valley 1300 species, then Anaimalai and adjoining areas about 2200 species have been reported. So while talking with the biodiversity or something related to the environment, we cannot omit the word forest. So people thought that forest is nothing but the gigantic trees associated ecosystem, but not exactly. But it is the world of insects, birds, amphibians, reptiles, mammals, as well as plants. It is an assemblage. It includes all the living beings, including microbes. See, it is a home to unicellular protozoa, to a gigantic land-living mammal, elephant. Not only that, it is a home for a unicellular fungus, to a gigantic angiospermic tree, that is banyan tree. Moreover, it nourishes our indigenous or traditional people, that is what we named as a tribal people. So here, according to National Remote Sensing Center 2018, so far 14 different types of forests have been reported in India, starting from western wet evergreen forest, semi evergreen forest, dry deciduous forest, thorn forest, subtropical fine forest, mountain wet temperate forest, mountain tropical, mountain moist temperate forest, subalpine forest, etc. So all these 14 different forest types, you know, very few types of forests alone have been attracted by the researchers, biologists, trekkers, or natural lovers. Of that, the more mountain wet temperate forest is most significant. That is what we named locally as Cholas. So these photographs are made clearly shows the diversity and the distribution of different forest types in India, with the four dominant type of forest, that is tropical dry deciduous forest, tropical moist deciduous forest, tropical thorn forest, as well as a tropical semi evergreen forest. So this is what I told, you know, Chola. Chola is the word derived from the word Tamil word that is Choli. So once upon a time, even in the literature or the ancient Tamil literature, they clearly mentioned about the word Chola. From that word, the Chola has been originated. But commercially or for scientific purpose, this Chola forest have been named as a tropical mountain forest, along with some other names too. So this is a grassland complex of Chola forest ecosystem, Mukurthi National Park. So here, the very few regions, you know, sheltered valleys alone occupied with a considerable quantity of evergreen trees. What do you mean by Chola? So simply known as wet evergreen mountain forest or southern mountain wet temperate forest or tropical mountain forest. It is a natural complex, that is an association between the grassland as well as evergreen trees. Those trees growing in evergreen forest, you know, they are stunted in nature. They can grow only up to 12 to 15 meter height. So what is the reason behind means we can discuss with the upcoming slide. Then this region, that is this kind of behavior, that is a mountain habitat, have been occupied between the 1400 to 2400 meter above sea level. Not only that, it is an isolated ecosystem at a large geographical scale. Moreover, it exhibits high endemism. That means it harbors higher number of endemic species. Interestingly, this region, you know, the Chola forest play a vital role in managing the hydrology along the slopes. So here clearly we can able to see the natural complex between the grassland as well as evergreen trees. See, wherever the sheltered valleys, you know, there the stunted trees grow in the evergreen forest ecosystem. There is the remaining exposed area to the wind, you know, there the grassland grow in a luxuriantly in the entire part of the hills. This is a typical example of the Chola forest ecosystem. How it has been originated? Scientists as well as the ancient literature, we have, you know, so many aspects, as well as we have a debate on the, as well as scientific debate on the origin of the Chola forest ecosystem. However, the pollen analysis collected from the sedimentation rock in Nilgiris, you know, concluded that this complex ecosystem, that means the Chola as well as a grassland, this complex ecosystem have been originated before 35,000 years ago. However, few scientists or few researchers worked behind the origin of this Chola forest. Then they concluded, as well as they proposed a different opinion or hypothesis regarding the origin of Chola. So regarding the one view, it is nothing but a final state as well as climax vegetation. Hope you studied about the final state or climax vegetation in ecological subject paper. So this stability, that means this final stability has been maintained by the different climatic conditions like a temperature, relative humidity, rainfall, as well as other environmental factors. Which this climatic condition, you know, which allow the vegetation of Chola forest, but it kill the other forest seedlings. Unfortunately, some other forest seedlings have been deposited on the Chola's ecosystem, you know, definitely that the climatic condition kill that particular forest seedlings. Regarding the hypothesis too, this Chola has been originated as well as created by the earlier pastoralists, that means cattle breeders. They artificially created this solar forest ecosystem that is a grassland. Here, the fire has controlled the growth and the maintenance of this entire forest ecosystem. But however, we need long-term studies on the analysis on the dynamic process of the vegetation of these regions. Then only we can able to conclude that this is the exact way or this is the exact reason behind the origin of such a wonderful solar ecosystem. So where it has been distributed, God has gifted to India, particularly to the Western Ghats. See, if we analyze the distributional rate of the solar forest ecosystem, that means this grassland as well as the grassland with the evergreen twin ecosystem have been distributed only in Tamil Nadu, Kerala, as well as in Karnataka. Considerably, the Tamil Nadu have, you know, wonderful quantity of the solar forest ecosystem, equally with the Kerala, Kerala too. But in Kerala, only three districts harbor this kind of ecosystem. In Karnataka, very considerable, very meager percentage of solar forest ecosystem have been reported. This is what I told, you know, if we analyze the physical nature of the solar forest, so here the temperature, relative humidity, altitude as well as rainfall is unique to this particular region. That is what the people or, you know, designated or the scientists confirmed this region as living fossils. Living fossils. Are they really important? Of the 14 different forest types have been reported by the National Remote Sensing Center, why should we take necessary importance or much importance to conserve on the biodiversity of this region? In the sense, definitely it has a wonderful value, not only the ecological but also the commercial value. See here, as I told, you know, water holding capacity. Usually, if the top root during the rainy season, if the top, the top of the hill receive the water through rainfall, you know, what will happen? It will immediately erode to the lower slope as well as at finally reach to the river or to the sea. This is what the exact process is happening in the entire mountains of India or several part of the country. But interestingly, here, yeah, important phenomena is happening. This is a region, you know, here this grassland has occupied a sedimented as a spongy-like structure. This spongy-like structure harvests as well as a hold considerable quantity of water during the rainy season. Thereafter, it will slightly release this water to these furrows. So these are the regions or these are the furrows harvest a considerable quantity of water from this entire region. This region not allow the elution of the entire water to the plain. Slightly only it will release this water. Finally, these eluted waters will be, you know, connected by these small channels. Then finally, so it will connect like the small streams. Okay, these streams finally make it as a large river. This river finally reach as a small rivulet, or it is, you know, duty to origin of several rivulets or rivers. Finally, all those water channels connected as a large waterfalls. So here we can correlate wherever we are getting a water throughout year from some forest region or waterfalls. So there may be a chance for the presence of solar forest. But we may not sure, but there may be a chance for the presence of solar forest. Why? Because we can't, you know, expect rain throughout the year of the 365 days, you know, we can't, you know, expect the rain. So these are the important sources as well as the role on water holding capacity in the soil. So this is the ecological significance of this particular solar forest ecosystem. But we cannot expect this kind of behavior from some other forest types too. So what are the other importance in the sense? I said, told, you know, it is nothing but a living fossils. We cannot create artificially this kind of ecosystem. Moreover, they are unable to expand due to its specific climatic conditions. They cannot, you know, expand. Once, how much quantity of the solar forests have been created by the nature, you know, that will be existed or that will be retained by the climatic condition, unless otherwise there is no possibility for, you know, expand of this solar forest. Moreover, it has a specific ecological value. Moreover, it harbors many endemic species of plants, animals, and microbes. As I told you, you know, it also is a home for several number of species. Also, the floristic richness and diversity is, you know, awesome here. As I told you, you know, this is a region is specific for high water retention capacity and exists as a precious source for the high altitude organism which is growing or living in that particular regions. Interestingly, see here, as I told you, you know, grassland as well as the solar evergreen trees, that tree roots can also able to store or hold some quantity of water. That root is, you know, considered as a shallow roots or succulent roots, which can able to store some quantity of water. So this is a reason behind we are, you know, simply naming this region is a you know, origin for many streams and rivers. So it helps for the regeneration of phytophagous insect. Solar forest regeneration can also be, you know, possible. Interestingly, some trees which is growing in the evergreen solar forest ecosystem, they are fire resistant. Quite commonly during the unfavorable season or summer season, the grassland may get fired. During that time, the trees which is growing in that area may be affected with, you know, fire. So interestingly, some trees like Rhododendron arboreum, you might have been heard about this, the name of the trees. So this is a peculiar, you know, behavior with these trees. It has this bark layer has a three more layer. The central core vasculature can be protected by the medium layer with its succulent tissues. The in between the layer is available, you know, that layer hold higher quantity of water that also prevent a heat shock from outside to the vascular bundle. So automatically during the favorable season or during the rainy season, this tree can rejuvenate immediately once you know fire happening in the particular solar forest ecosystem. Whereas the other trees, you know, may take some times to rejuvenate, but this tree is nothing but a fire resistant tree. Immediately it will rejuvenate. Hope you have, you know, seen this tree in quite commonly in different parts of the, you know, high altitudes of Tamil Nadu as well as in Kerala. This is what I told. So these are some important specific region in which higher quantity of solar forests have been reported. Upper Palani Hills, this is nothing but your Kodaikanal. So Agasyamalai, this is so-called rain forest. This region is receiving higher quantity of, yes? Okay. Receives higher quantity of, you know, rain during the rainy days. Agasyamalai, this region with both grassland as well as evergreen trees complex. Anamudi, highest peak in South India. Of course, it is a hotspot as well as a home for several endemic species of herbs. So this is a region in which only several strict endemic species have also been reported. So Nilgiris, when compared to the other part of the region in Tamil Nadu as well as in Kerala, the Nilgiris hold a good quantity of solar forest as well as evergreen tree complex. So then Pambar Sola here also. Then Pakshi Padalam in Wayanad, Kerala. So this region is very famous as well as unique. Why? Because the Pakshi in the sense birds, Padalam, Burli, Burli full of birds. This region is famous for report of higher number of bird diversity. So here more number of bird species have been reported in this region. It's a potential hotspot for bird species too. So Iravikulam National Park, this is only a national park established to protect or conserve our Nilgiri tar. That Nilgiri tar is nothing but a key fauna as well as a key animal of this solar forest ecosystem. They cannot live the other ecosystem, you know, other than the solar forest. So Silent Valley, so this region also a good quantity as well as a quality solar forest can be seen. Ponmudi, once this region is, you know, excellent for in the case of biodiversity as well as and its component, but nowadays ecotourism considerably spoil this natural ecosystem, but very meager quantity of solar forest ecosystem is existing in this region. So Madi Kettan Sola. So while reading the name, the PP may thought that while entering into the forest, definitely we may get confused or we may lose our sense or knowledge, but not exactly. If we consider the biologists, trekkers or forest dwellers, they have some tricks to roam in and around the forest regions. How to go to some other part or where we came or from where we hope to go. Such a way, they have some tricks, natural tricks. Of that, the sunlight, that is one of the important trick. So through which we can able to trace from where we came or which direction we are coming or which direction we have to go. But here, 100% sunlight penetration is absent because of the thick canopy of this forest which is growing in these regions. So this is a reason behind the naming of this Madikattan Sola. So don't think that if you get inside the forest or if you enter into the forest, we may lose our sense or knowledge. There is no plant species or no external component reported to lose your sense or knowledge. So Meghamalai as well as the misty mountains, this is also a wonderful hotspot according to me. Why? Because from which we have documented so much quantity of biodiversity. Pambadam Chola. So what about the undergrowth? See, if you are considering the tree evergreen sites, it is simply looking like a grass. Is it only with the grass? Not exactly. This grass ecosystem associated with diversified herbaceous species like Utricularia or Eriocallana or Smithia. See here. So such a way, the entire grassland ecosystem can be occupied with a wide variety of species, say for example, your Utricularia or some other insectivore species can also be, Drosera can also be seen here. Or otherwise, in some cases, we can see only with Utricularia or Eriocallana complex, but we may not expect such a unique ecosystem. Why? Because this grassland is a complex. So many species can be permitted. This is not an exact solar forest floor. This is cast plate in Maharashtra, but it is not a component. Why I'm showing this photograph, the solar forest grassland may not be like this, like an individual or like a monoculture. It may not be like this. So are they really paradise of biodiversity? Yeah, of course, definitely it's a paradise of biodiversity. How far in the sense? It is a home for some specific floristic element or floristic component like Elaeocarpus, Mycelia, Rhododendron, Actinodaphne, Exarchum, Garcinia, Eugenia, Impatiens, Habeneria, Drosera, Cypress, etc. Hence, the living being or diversity of life form from the unicellular floristic wealth of the angiosperms, definitely we can able to conclude that Fabaceae, Orchidaceae as well as Mystaceae are the three important families distributed with a higher number of species. So we are only targeted to analyze the angiosperm diversity. Why? Because the diversity of angiosperm in this particular region is fantastic, as well as more diversified. So spectacular colored or more complex plant life can also be seen in this grassland as well as in the evergreen trees. So if we analyze undergrowth, so we can also see some lower plants or fungi like organisms, Samanita muscaria, hope you know, it's a toxic mushroom, Leucocoprinus, edible mushroom. Of course, Termitomyces, wherever the termite mats have been formed, there we can see. Lepiota, recently the anti-cancerous drug has been extracted from this mushroom. Of course, natural dye can be extracted. Why I'm telling this, you know, people thought that the solar forests are not commercially valuable or commercially important. That is what, see, I'm projecting some photographs of some medicinally as well as a commercially important lower organism as well as, you know, higher plant species. Colitricia, of course, commercially valuable Bolitinus, Polyporus, then again Colitricia. This is a magic mushroom. Once it is very common in the higher altitude regions of Mannavanur as well as Pundi, nearby areas in Kodaikanal. This is nothing but this mushroom has been used as a drug in the local people as well as it has been supplied to the tourist too. Recently, the collection as well as the consumption of this mushroom have been stopped by the, you know, government of Tamil Nadu. So Ganoderma, information required to explain all those things, you know, about this. This mushroom is a source for anti-cancerous drug, commercially available in the. So this grow arkins is a algae as well as a fungal association of this lichen, you know, it indicates the health of the particular forest regions. By the presence of this lichen skin indicate the forest is in good health as well as a good condition. So this, you know, this clearly indicate the moisture content of the soil as well as the environment. This bryophyte is a source for, you know, high altitude herbivores. Of course, it nourishes enormous diversity of a smaller, you know, herbivores or otherwise some deer or those herbivores available in the solar forest ecosystem. So of course, pogonatum, quite common, rocky orophytic species. Rocky with a considerable quantity of soil is enough to reproduce. Of course, tree trunk with a soft as well as water holding capacity can be permitted to grow the organisms like Hookeriopsis potacamundiana. It's a very common species. Ecosystem, once people thought that it is a indicator of gold mine, of course through that only the entire ecosystem have been, you know, over exploited. This is also, you know, under the verge of extinction. Sciathiae. So imagine those who are going to Kodaikanal, Ooty or some part of higher altitude, if you see this tree like structure or tree fern, definitely you can imagine once that place should be a solar forest. That place must be, you know, over exploited or converted for commercial purpose, but this is an indicator tree, so we can able to confirm this region must be a solar forest. So of course, during the British colonial period, our natural vegetation have been over exploited. The British people collected a good quality of wood from our forest region, and this has been, you know, exported to the UK. Not only that, they did another one, you know, problem with our ecosystem. They planted the exotic trees like a pinus, wattle, or eucalyptus in our natural environment. That will create a nuisance to our natural endemic species. Not only that, that over exploit, that will exploit our endemic species, animal as well as a plant species. So this is one such example. Pinus monophylla, so planted in the most part of the higher altitude. Of course, Pinus gerardiana, these two. So not only that, it is a home for, you know, wonderful plant species, charismatic species, or otherwise simply say spectacular colored, handsome, you know, flowers, plants with the handsome flowers. This is one such group. Impatiens, so far about more than 1200 species have been reported in the world. In India alone, we have about 300 something species, but almost 99% of the species may attract the, you know, forest dwellers or natural lovers. So this is one such species, Impatiens tangachi. So again, Impatiens parasitica. So why I'm you know, emphasizing this kind of you know, value, in the sense these species can be, you know, commercialized for, you know, the usage of the common people, such a way the economy can also be improved. So this is a very few number of individuals, not a more number, very few number of individuals alone existing in this species like impatiens, Coelotropis as well as impatiens, Platina. But according to me, we are working behind the impatiens, Platina, but there is no living, surviving living individuals available in the natural habitat. So impatiens Gerardiana, Gardneriana, sorry. Recently we described this species, impatiens Matthewiana, orophytic species, impatiens elegans, impatiens Cocheriana, impatiens Cotralensis, Dindigalensis, recently we described, of course, Tamil Nadensis, we described this, Palniensis. Of course, it's a quite common, once it was very common in the Kodaikanal and around, but nowadays very, very, very rare in the forest floor. The same species. So this species, because of the Abnathis weed, which is growing, you know, some Ringostylis species, Cyperaceae member, that occupy the entire aquatic pond ecosystem. These impatiens, you know, the specific habitat is a pond ecosystem. By the invasion of this exotic species, Ringostylis, that will completely kill the natural vegetations. Lesionality impatiens. Of course, Cymbalocos cochinchinensis is a key tree species, can be seen in each and every corner of the Shola forest ecosystem, particularly in the evergreen Shola. So Strobilanthus kundiana, about 42 species of Strobilanthus kundiana have been reported. So people thought that the Kurunji can flower once in a 12 years, but not exactly. The Kurunji can flower every year, but it will grow as well as, you know, combined form of flowering. That is a mass flowering can be seen only once in a 12 years. That is what we may thought that the Kurunji flowers in 12 years, but not exactly. So this is a closer view of Kurunji, Nila Kurunji. So of course this is another kind of Kurunji flower, key component. Then Uzbekia, this is a closer view of this Uzbekia. Then Sonarula, it is also one of the key element. Wherever the rocky mountains or rocky region with smaller quantity of soil is there, you know, there this kind of species will grow. So this also indicate the presence of Shola forest ecosystem, Sonarula parmeswarini. Then Garcinia, it is another component. It is simply known as, gamboge tree or simply known as kodambuli in Malayalam. So several species, about 27 species have been reported in India alone, including several endemic as well as endangered species. It is one among the trees under verge of extinction, Garcinia imboti. So this is another tree, Garcinia travancorica, strict endemic to Agassizmalai Biosphere Reserve. Ophioraisa, see separate the word Ophioraisa, Ophio snake, Raisa root. Once the root of this plant is used as an antidote for a snake bite. So Ophioraisa mungos is the only plant used for that purpose. But thereafter, several species have been tried as well as standardized for as a drug for the antidote for a snake bite. So Ophioraisa radicans, then again Rauwolfia, you know that the same, this root of this plant can also be used as antidote for snake bite. It's a quite common species, Rauwolfia hookeri, Heliocarpus. So in India, about 35 species of Heliocarpus have been reported. Particularly in Western Ghats, we have 13 species. Because of the religious belief, the seeds of the particular species of Heliocarpus have been collected by the forest dwellers or traders or some other commercial agency. So due to that, the considerable quantity of living individuals in the forest have been declined drastically. Say for example, these are the few important as well as significant Heliocarpus species distributed in in different parts of the Western Ghats. So this indicates, the seeds alone indicates its extinction rate. Because of this religious belief only, the considerable species like, see here, this is one such a species, the seeds have been collected in the natural forest region that has been sold in the market for commercial purposes. Not only that, India is a central market for the trade of the Heliocarpus seeds, that is simply known as Rudraksha seeds. So again, Heliocarpus tuberculatus, see nowadays, you know, during the Sabarimala season, the you know, pilgrimage have also forced to buy these, you know, seeds of this Rudraksha. So this is another kind of Rudraksha trees. So this is, you should know, this is the only surviving individual, only one tree is available in the world as a surviving individuals. So different special measures have been undertaken to protect this tree species from extinction. We are also working behind this species on conservation. So again, one more Heliocarpus, that is a Rudraksha species. So this is a commercially important species, locally known as Karai. So Curcuma pseudomontana, once it is a very common in the forest floor, but nowadays these species have been cultivated by the local forest people for commercial purpose. So Decalopis salicifolia or Altilleria salicifolia, this herbaceous species was once very quite common in the rocky mountains of Agassimala biosphere of Palni Hills. This succulent root, you know, that has a wonderful property against, you know, to control ulcer. It on the ulcer effect of this root, you know, over-exploited by the, you know, commercially important companies as well as, you know, pharmaceutical companies. They are asking the local people or tribal people to collect this rhizome of this particular species. Of course, Decalopis arealpatra or formerly Janaki arealpatra, this is also most significant herbaceous species. Of course, some wide range of herbaceous members can also be seen in the entire part of the grassland as well as the sheltered valley of Enosola forest. Crotalaria, we can see wide variety of Crotalaria species can be seen. Then, of course, Lucas hirta, the higher hilltop as well as, you know, a smaller grassland associated ecosystem, there we can see such a wonderful species. This is also named as a key flora, also a key plant species of Sola forest ecosystem, Rhodomyrtus tomentosa. We have only one species in this genus in India. Of course, Syzygium, so far 75 species of Syzygium have been reported in India, particularly Tamil Nadu and Kerala alone hold higher number of Syzygium. That means 46 species we have, whereas the remaining state harbor only few numbers. Why? Because I'm emphasizing, you know, Syzygium is simply known as novel. We know only about the Syzygium gumini. Edible novel species only knows about the people, but in India alone we have 75 species of Syzygium. But the most of the species, you know, reported under verge of extinction. They are under, you know, very much a dangerous situation. We need to protect, or we need to take necessary step to conserve this species. See another novel species, Syzygium sylanicum. This one we described this species recently, Syzygium barbi. These two we have described recently, Syzygium malacans. Then Syzygium ramavarma, Syzygium bedomi, mundagam, then Travancoricum. This is, once it is very common tree in Kerala part in the swamp as well as some other regions, but nowadays the distribution is very rare. Syzygium magendre, Syzygium munroni, then Syzygium bendamianum. This is another sister species, Syzygium sethurans. So once it was a common genus, Syzygium had been separated from the Jambosa from Eugenia and Syzygium. So cinnamon, you know that Lavanga Pattai or Brinji Elai, so many commercial names are available. So many species, about 27 species of cinnamon have been reported in India. So almost 90% of the species are commercially valuable. This species under reported under critically endangered category. Again, is a commercially valuable cinnamon, Pattai. So of course, Magnolia, Actino Daphne Borneae. This is because of its medicinal property. This shrub has been, you know, overexploited by the local people or commercially important companies. In the forest floor, we can see a tiny, as well as a wonderful or fantastic colored flower yielding plants like orchids. So this is also very quite common in the forest floor, which can you know, retain their rhizome during the unfavorable season. So I have an area, few examples. Of course, in good colored, as well beautifully colored orchids like this can be seen as a epipod in different you know, herbaceous, you know, tree trunks. Of course, cyanotis, quite common in the grassland ecosystem. Of course, Alizicarpus, Nodania, different species with different morphotypes. I'm not, you know, expert on the identification as well as, you know, categorization of animals. Of course, I found some key fauna on that particular regions. Particularly, see here, primates. It is a wonderful creature. Why? Because they are also benefiting and also helps to benefit by the particular ecosystem. It is a wonderful, you know, creature to dispose the seeds. Several primates, so far about 800 primate species have been reported in the world, but particularly this Nilgiri Langur is a key element. Wherever you are seeing that in a particular solar forest ecosystem, definitely we can expect this kind of creature as well as this kind of animals on the, you know, forest ecosystem. Again, once it is a very common primate as well as a macaque, lion-tailed macaque, but during the, you know, before 1980, so this you know, langur has been, you know, exported for commercially pharmaceutical company to test the you know, medicines. So thereafter, during the Indira Gandhi period only, we stopped it for the export of this kind of you know, langur to the foreign companies. So thereafter, several conservation steps or also some measures have been taken to protect these kind of, you know, macaques. It's a wonderful creature too. The elephant, no need to explain. Wherever you are seeing the elephant in the natural forest ecosystem, definitely we can say that forest ecosystem is in good health. So see that in that back, you know, so much of see here, so much of eucalyptus species have been planted, but of course this is obnoxious as well as invasive. This will danger to this organism too. So they cannot take this kind of you know, herbs for edible purpose or other commercial purpose. These animals may not touch or don't touch that kind of obnoxious weeds. Why? Because that weeds are highly toxic too. So this organism is also helping to dispose the forest ecosystem from one place to another. It is also helped to disperse the seeds of the particular species from one place to another. So it is a wonderful creature. Grizzled giant squirrel, or the one more species is there, Malabar giant squirrel. During the favorable season or fruiting season, what they will do means they will collect the fruits as well as the seeds and create a you know, furrow in the forest floor. Not only that, after, you know, say, depositing that particular seeds, that furrow will be completely closed by soil. This is a wonderful, you know, duty function by this kind of organisms. What will happen over a period of time, that seeds what he has, you know, deposited or he has, you know, submerged in the soil will be, you know, rejuvenated as well as developed as a new seedlings. Such a wonderful forest seedling developer developing behavior has been done by this organisms, giant squirrel. So Indian gar here also, as I told you, know the climate has a wonderful role to maintain the grassland ecosystem to avoid the overgrowth. Such a way, organisms like this, you know, this organism forage the, you know, younger shootlet or, you know, overgrown shootlet of grassland ecosystem to control the exact nature of the forest ecosystem. Then not only the climatic factors, but also with some biotic factor like this. So it will completely forage. So it will help to maintain the solar forest as such. This is also a key forest regions. So barking deer, once it is very common, usually we may not see this kind of deer in the natural forest ecosystem. Why? Because such a, you know, shy type of organisms, we can't see this kind of, you know, organism. It is a strictly endemic species to South India, particularly mouse deer. It is also very, you know, tiny creature. It depends the fruits pieces or, you know, leaf pieces deposited by the primates or macaque or langur. Wherever the macaque is going in the tree, you know, there this organism may, you know, follow that. Then and only they can able to, you know, satisfy with their food scarcity. As I told you, know, it is a key element. Wherever the solar forest is existing or remnants of solar forest is existing, there only this kind of creature can, you know, able to survive, whereas the remaining forest ecosystem may not support for the growth and development of this Nilgiri tar. It is our, you know, state animal. These two state bird of Tamil Nadu, once it is very common, the suitable tree for the breeding system has, you know, damaged. That is the reason behind the, you know, extinction of the as well as the extinction rate of this emerald pigeon in the natural habitat. But of course, commercially, this pigeon has bred by, you know, South Asian countries like Java, Sumatra, Philippines. There, the people are, you know, breeding this pigeon, commercially selling in the market. Feathered forester, simply known as, if they will live or survive in the only in the top of the canopy. So much of story, so much of scientific information available with this great Malabar hornbill. So we don't have a time, due to time constraint, I'm skipping this. It is also a wonderful creature, but because of the head part, you know, see ornamental head part, the local people are commercially, record peoples are collecting or killing this board from the forest regions. We have undertaken a study, detailed investigation on the ecological value of the solar forest of Palani Hills. So far here, you know, only 10 solar forests have been reported by the forest department. We have documented about 34 solar forests from this region. So these are the exclusively endemic species reported in the different parts of the Palani Hills, like Actinodominium borneae, Ficus anglidae, then Sonarilla palaniensis, etc. So the list is, you know, continuing. So not only that in endemic species, but also several species have been listed as under verge of extinction or endangered, vulnerable, or threatened, least concern, so on. So we are in need to take a special attention, or protocol has to be considered such a you know, species under verge of extinction. So okay, so this much importance are available. So they are ecologically unique or commercially important, as well as wonderful creature. Whether they are in safe condition, in the sense, definitely the answer is no. See here, the tourism spoil the considerable part of the solar forest ecosystem. In the initial stage, I told you, know, this is one of the important region in which the hydrological importance can be emphasized here. That forest floor or soil can prevent a considerable quantity of water. Thereafter, it will release slightly and to create the origin of several rivers as well as streams or rivulets. But while depositing such a, you know, obnoxious material or nuisance material, definitely the soil nature will be, you know, damaged. The solar forest may lose their originality or the unable to stagnate or unable to store the water for the future years. Here, urbanization. So every day the construction process is going on. The urbanization as well as the forest clearing for commercial tea or coffee or other important crops like cardamom, clove, pepper, even for vegetable crops. So we may lose the precious source of our earth. That is what the solar forest. So while providing the while supporting this, ultimately after 15 or 100 years, definitely this region may be occupied by tea plantations only instead of the normal as well as a regular tree species. So exotic species, simply you may purchase or you may collect some plants from your nursery or nearby area. You will keep some for some times. Thereafter, you will simply throw to the nearby regions or somewhere. You don't know the problem created by that ornamental plant, what you have thrown in the natural environment. So in order to avoid that, please be aware what are the plants can be grow as ornamental or what are the plants can be avoided. Such a way only we can able to manage or we can able to maintain the ecosystem as balanced. So if you throw that particular obnoxious weed or ornamental plant, definitely that will create a nuisance to several animal species or natural plant species. Even some species may damage the root system of the gigantic trees. See here, wattle, that means acacia species, eucalyptus species, then pine species, or otherwise several cedrus, cryptomeria, cupressus. See, imagine while going to the Kodaikanal, so while looking that pine forest, definitely we should be ashamed. Why? Because it is not a beauty, If you see the undergrowth of the soil, definitely that area will be too much ugliness. According to me, that soil is too much sterile soil. You can't create or you can't, germinate an individual seedling in that soil. Why? Because that sedimentation litter of the pinus or some obnoxious plant, completely damage the soil. That is a real trick made by the British people to, damage our natural environment. Because of that only, they planted so much of pine, wattle, eucalyptus, or acacia species in our wonderful creatures in the mountains. So not only that, we have also did a considerable duty by planting so many commercially important trees or plant species like cinchona, apple, pear, peach, or coffee plantation, or so much of ornamental species. So we need, time being, we need that beautifulness of the particular campus or the particular region, but thereafter, we are not at all bothering about that obnoxious weed. So that will create too much damage to that environment. Okay, so these are the, I have listed, these are the impact of exotic weed we planted or we throw in the forest litter, are commercially planted, are introduced by the government. So much of reason may be say, but the reason behind to avoid, in the sense, we need to protect our native species. So this is what I told: obnoxious weed, eucalyptus. So what will happen in the solar forest during the British colonial period? They planted so much of eucalyptus species or wattle species. Our native seedling may not grow there due to the heavy wind, about 40 to 70 kilometers speed. The heavy wind may spoil our native seedling, but this exotic plant or trees can be grown here. That is a real reason they will withstand in the upper hills in the solar region. Say automatically we lost our natural ecosystem. Moreover, these seeds may be deposited in the valleys. Finally, this region has also been occupied with this obnoxious weeds like a eucalyptus as well as a wattle. So see here, in the solar forest, seedlings grown. See here, once it was a solar forest, but the eucalyptus has occupied the solar forest region. The so-called, why I'm emphasizing, you know, nowadays, the trees of India is under verge of extinction, not only in India, but in the entire world. See here, about 21 species of trees are under verge of extinction. This is not my perspective. This is according to the International Union for Conservation of Natural and Natural Resources, 2020 census. So we need to take a special emphasis, as well as a special attention to conserve the trees. See, if we are unable to protect the trees, definitely we may lose our climatic condition, definitely leads to lose our rainfall and other features. So for that, housing and urban areas, so we have to reduce smallholder farming has to be controlled. So again, forest, subtropical forest under verge of extinction. So finally, I reached the conclusion part. So of course, we need to reclimate, or we need to do something for the protection of the solar forest. Before that, what we need to do? First, we have to document the different solar forests distributed in India. So wherever the name or local name has been provided, you know, we have to document. We need to support the research by providing financial support to do some project on conservation perspective. Moreover, we need a field-based map through geographical information system. Then only nobody will, you know, cheat the government or the common people or natural lovers. So also we need to document the floristic, what are the floristic elements in the particular solar forest. We have to identify the endemic and the rare trees in the particular area. Moreover, special importance has to be given in the academic as well as a research meeting by the organization. So being a botanist or being a zoologist or a classical biologist, we are not at all interested to do something for the environment, but also we have been oriented to do a simple research by means of tools or instruments. Nowadays, the research have been oriented towards the instruments only, not by judging the knowledge of the particular researchers. So we have to escape from the lab. We have to move towards the forest or some other natural environment. We have to concentrate. Then only we can able to realize what is happening in the environment, what are the problem associated with the environment. Unless otherwise, we can't do, or we may not expect Ayurveda herbal. Simply in the name we can say Ayurveda or herbal, but there will be no source for the formulation of chemicals through the environment. Where you are getting the medicine, it is not in the market or not in the commercial website, but the source, that is a plant product, must be originated from the field only or in the forest only. So we must take a special measure or special attention to protect such a wonderful environment, particularly like solar forest. So moreover, as I told, so much of obnoxious weeds have been originated, occupied in the solar forest ecosystem. So we must remove that unwanted trees or unwanted plant species in the environment. Okay, so up to here I'm stopping. Say sorry, I have taken much time. I have taken some much time. So before concluding that, I must thank the management, the principal, head of the department. Particularly, I have to thank Dr. Selvaraj, the other faculty members for providing the opportunity to share my views. Why? Because nowadays research is targeted in the towards only instrumentation only. The people, very few people only interested to do research in the environment. I am one such person. We have dedicated not only me, my associate, my research scholar, past and the present. Every person have in their mind we need to protect some environment. So up to here I am stopping. Those who have any doubts, clarification, you can post through a chat box or you can ask directly. I am ready to speak.
Dr. Ramasubu, I am Ramasubramanian.
Thank you so much, sir. Very nice to see you, sir.
Thank you. I have few questions that...
Please, sir.
You have said that solar forest being polluted by various contaminants from the domestic, that is plastic and polythene box.
Yes,
and
sir.
The other things you showed a slide also.
Yes, sir.
Is it so that the solar forest is a deeper way? I mean, is the people are moving inside the solar forest and they go, depositing all these things because it is a forest, this is prevented by the forest department.
Yes,
are they allowing people to go into the entire the deep forest and deposited all these obnoxious materials there?
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, the entire hill of Kodaikanal, you know, where the town is situated, that area is once it was a solar forest. Moreover, what are the tourist spots spotted by the government of Tamil Nadu as well as a forest official, you know, almost all the regions once it was a solar forest. So that nowadays, you know, people have been permitted. Even today, you can go to the Berijan. That is a protected area under, you know, MAB program. That area must be protected. But in the name of tourism, you know, the people have been permitted to get inside. There, they are simply, you know, depositing unwanted materials, even liquor bottles in that particular area. So that is the reason behind it. We must, you know, careless tourism must be, you know, implemented by the,
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
All the best. Thank you.
Nice to see you, sir. Nice to see you, sir. Nice to see you. If you have any doubts, clarification, please post your questions. Is there any doubts? You can also post through chat box. Okay, I think no doubts for participants. Selvara, sir, you can proceed.
Okay, sir. Sir, one question is about solar forest is not extensible, means the seed germination is lesser. Dr. P. Kumar asked the question, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. Solar forest is not extendable means the seed germination risk. Not exactly, what is happening here in the sense that particular region, the phytogeography as well as the climatic condition of the particular region is very specific. If the forest seedlings, the seeds of the particular region, solar forest individuals, if they deposited the seedlings in its natural habitat, means definitely they can grow. So unfortunately, if the primates harvest or if the birds harvest the seeds of the solar forest trees and deposited apart from the solar forest ground, in the sense, definitely the seeds may not grow. So they can grow only in the solar habitat. If the seeds have been deposited outside the, you know, natural habitat, means definitely they can grow. Moreover, the tree species which is growing apart from the solar forest may be deposited in the solar ground. That seedling may also killed by the peculiar climatic condition of the solar forest. So vice versa, that particular region alone will be healthy as well as grow luxuriantly, but they may not permit the seeds to grow inside. Also, they don't want to grow outside. That is the real reason behind the people are telling, you know, this is a living fossil. They are unable to expand. Moreover, artificially we may not create. The government of Tamil Nadu forest, you know, they developed a plan to reclimate or reintroduce this solar forest individual to other part of the hills. But unfortunately, all the efforts have been, you know, failed because they need a peculiar climatic condition like a relative humidity, rainfall, as well as a temperature. Unless otherwise, we can't do artificially to that natural ecosystem.
Okay, sir. Students.
Another important thing I wanted to state here.
Yes, sir.
You said about the eucalyptus cultivations.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The eucalyptus cultivation in between Tanjore and Pudukote, which has caused the groundwater level decrease,
and
it is being recorded. The eucalyptus people are thought that it is a minor forest cultivation or ecoforest cultivation, something like that, by the government project. Previously, the government advocated the cultivation of eucalyptus. Now, I understand that the government has stopped that project and all. The eucalyptus cultivation is not only increases the, it is not increasing the forest, but it causes a problem to the forest. It by absorbing groundwater level also. That
is absolutely true, sir.
Yeah. That is also been recorded, and I came to know that also.
Yes, sir. True, sir.
Thank you.
Students, if you have any doubts, please feel free to ask our chief guest. Anyone?
I think most of the people are working in the laboratory, you know. they may not aware on the environment as well as the forest. So I request hereafter, please be enjoy the environment. Just do a mini small research as well as you just concentrate through, you know, photographs, videos, like that. Then only, moreover, I request the teachers, please be encourage the younger generation regarding the conservation aspect of different forest. Not only the forest, but also to our environment. It is a duty of the teachers too. I request all the, please be encouraged the younger generation as well as motivate to conserve the biodiversity of our earth.
It is unfortunate to note that many colleges have stopped going tour with the students.
Yes, sir.
And that itself a great damage to the botany culture, because the students are unable to understand the what is solar forest, how it will be like that. And that is the thing I must point out here. Many colleges stopped students going tour. That is the thing. And it was not like olden days where we used to go even up to Delhi, Haridwar, Rishikesh. Hope Seluraj might be remembering that.
Yes, sir. All India tour.
Yeah.
Okay. So if it is okay, please proceed for further, I think one
okay,
more.
Sir.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable and knowledge gaining presentation. Thank you is the best prayer that anyone could say. I say that on a lodge. Thank you express extreme gratitude, humility, and understanding. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. K. Selvaraj, sir, Assistant Professor, G. Vengaswamy Naidu College, to deliver the vote of thanks. Please, sir.
Selvaraj, sir, unmute yourself. Unmute. Yes.
Okay, sir. Sir, good afternoon to all. This is a time to tell thanks to all. First, I thank the college management and the principal and the head of the department, those who have immediately accepted my invitation to conduct the seminar like this. And also, I thank the today's chief guest, Dr. R. Ramasubu, sir. He immediately accept our invitation and delivered a wonderful lecture. So it is very well useful to all student communities and also. Then I thank my guide and my mentor, Dr. V. Ramasubramanian, sir, because of his guidance, now I am here. Dr. Ramasubramanian, sir, and my dear teachers, Dr. Sendil, sir, Dr. Densing Balaya, sir, and my dear friends and my department colleagues, Dr. V. Uma ma'am, and Dr. Karthik sir, Dr. Malchami, Dr. P. Kumar. Through their support, I conduct this wonderful webinar. And also, my dear friends, Dr. G. Pandiyajan, Dr. M. Sellapandian, all are helped this webinar conduct very well. And my dear junior students also, Dr. G. Maniandan and Dr. M. Murugan, these people also helped to conduct the webinar. Finally, I thank our department labor assistant, Mr. Parasuram sir, and all my dear colleagues and my dear student friends. In the first semester students and the second year, third year BSc students of J. Venkatraman Naidu College. Finally, I thank one and all. Thank you. Thank you.
We personally thank other college staff members and students for joining us. Thank you.
Shall we close, sir? Is there any other formality, sir? Shall we close?